This is the SparkFun FreeSoc2, which is based on the Cypress PSoC5 programmable SoC fabric. It's running a program, I bet you can guess what program it's running. It's running a program that I got off the Arduino platform, and it's the first program you run on everything Arduino. The beauty of the Arduino platform is that it brings all sorts of hardware to a lowest common denominator. And let's see if you can guess what the program is before I get it into focus here. Blinky, blinky, blinky. The hello world of the hardware universe. With this little blinky program and the wisdom of the Arduino programmers, the original developers, you can take any hardware and bring it down to your level. Now, Blink is only made to as a proof of concept so that you can make sure that you can program whatever the heck you're looking at. And we all know the Arduino platform has hundreds of libraries that let you run all sorts of things from music to video, audio, sensors, robotics. And the beauty of the Arduino platform is that you can take all of that complexity and put it into whatever hardware you want. That's true. But sometimes the hardware itself is more powerful than the environment that you're programming it into. This bad boy is a monster. And right now, it's running a little blinky program. And this is about as impressive as taking a Ferrari 360 Spider, the top down in your driveway, turning the blinker on and sitting there. And I would say, hey there, do you have 500 horsepower mid-engine under the boot? And you'd say, well, yes, I do. And I'd say, do you have high performance racing slicks? And you'd say, yes, I do. And I'd say, do you have 6-speed paddle shifters and a high performance transmission? And you'd say, yes, I do. And I'd say, what the heck are you doing sitting there in the driveway with the blinkers on? Yeah. And here, let me put up a picture of the pinout. You can take a look at that. This is the pins mapped into Arduino's terminology. It also has the PSoC terminology right next to it. Okay, let's take a look around the board here. I'm going to use the microscope so you can see the little solder pad thingies that let you switch different features in and out. So this is on the top left. You can add your own power if you'd like. There's a bypass here for, I guess, the diode if you accidentally reverse bias something, but you get a drop with it whenever you hook a diode in, so you may want to bypass that out. This particular board has two processors in it. One is the CY8C5868LTI, low power. That's a smaller SoC, and then there's the target right there, the larger one. And what the smaller one is set up to do is it's acting as a debugger. Now, what does that mean, debugger? What it means is that it is essentially, what it means is that I'm going to tell you something even more confusing. It's acting as an in-circuit emulator, an ICE. If you're familiar with embedded programming, if you do it for a living, you probably don't need me to explain that to you. But if you don't, what an in-circuit emulator does is it sits there and is able to interrogate the individual registers and the memory of the target processor as the code executes line by line by line. In, you know, if you're familiar with software debuggers, it basically lets you do a, you know, GDB kind of software debugging with hardware. And typically what you'd have to do is you'd have to get an outboard ICE and you'd have to plug it into the data stream or the main bus, and this has it built in. So you can actually, if you use the PSoC environment, I believe PSoC Creator, when you're running the code, you can actually see what's happening line by line in the code. If you're if you try to do the same thing on a typical Arduino, good luck, because there is no such debugger on the for the Atmels that we know of or that we have available to us through Arduino code. Typically, what we do in with our Arduino code is we add print statements all over the place so we can print out the status of various variables as things are happening. That's legitimate too, but the ICE makes it much more convenient. Here in the lower left, we've got a 12-volt input. We can set the board to run at either 5 volts or 3.3 volts. I've got a set of 3.3 now. There you have your two voltage regulators. You've got a port for the debugger. I guess there's some very fine-grained pin port there. You got another port for a hardware port you can put in for the target. I'm not sure what you would do with that, but you could do it. Here you can enable the I2C. If you solder those things, connect those things together. There's the flashy, blinky user LED, which is what we're doing. Coming down here, we can put a 25 megahertz crystal if we want really, if we want to control the clock really closely. We can put a crystal in there, and you won't have the silicon clock taking care of things. And then I guess these would be for the two outboard capacitors. We can also put a 32 megahertz crystal in, or 32 kilohertz, excuse me, crystal in if you want to run the real-time clock and have it actually keep time. There's the bypass for the two analog to digital converters. They call them SARs for some reason, not quite sure why. There's your typical Arduino header if you want to program it using a programmer. The target reset button and a user controllable button. And as you look around the edge, you'll see there are all kinds of pins that are labeled not only with the Arduino labeling, but also with the PSoC labeling. And there's a good reason for that. And I think what you're going to find is as you're using this in the Arduino environment, yeah, you can use it exactly like any other Arduino. You can use it just like you could make the Teensy work like an Arduino, just like, you know, we've seen the Photon can be programmed like an Arduino. But the truth is, if you use this thing like an Arduino, you're basically giving up about 98% of the power, and I'll show you why. Now, here's why I'm suggesting there's a lot of power in this unit that you won't be taking advantage of if you just use the Arduino platform. Now, the beauty of the Arduino platform is you've got the libraries, you've got compatibility with everything else. You can this is a high-speed processor, and you can use it that way. But take a look at this. What this is the architecture of the PSoC5 CPU. Or the PSoC5 SoC fabric. It's not basically, it's not a simple CPU. The CPU, the embedded processor, is this right here. It's an ARM Cortex M3. Now, when we program this like an Arduino, what we're basically doing is taking all this other stuff out and just talking to that one little box right there as if it was an Atmel chip. You know, not that Atmel doesn't make nice, big, complicated chips, but for the Arduino's sake, you kind of want to use all these other things. Now, what are these things? There's an entire analog system here. There's a way to get analog signals, analog or like music and video and any kind of continuous waveform. We can bring in an analog waveform. We can digitize it. We can process it. We can do cool things to it. And then we can send it out again. We've got a digital system of that they're calling Universal Digital Block Array. Now, what that is like is an FPGA. If you don't know what an FPGA is, you can go over Dave Jones's EEV blog. He's got a great video explaining what FPGAs are. But with that, in a nutshell, an FPGA allows you to take something you would normally do in software and put it into hardware. The reason you want to put things into hardware is they run really, really, really fast. Software, you got to execute command by command by command. When you put it into hardware, the hardware just does it. It doesn't execute anything. It just does the algorithm that you've picked. So you've got a complicated array here that has built into it Oh, it's got I squared C, IO, it's got a UART in there, it's got some signal processors, you have timers and counters and interrupts and a CAN bus all over the place, you have system-wide resources, multiple clocks, multiple interrupts, you've got a way to put the whole thing to sleep so that it runs on picoamps, so you can build a system, have it go to sleep using virtually no battery power at all and wake up and do things. And then you've got GPIOs and you've got a USB PHY on the output here. And you've got ways to standardize the clocks either to a real-time clock for the 32 kilohertz or you can put a 25 between 4 and 25 megahertz clock in here and have it run at the speeds that you like. This is an amazing system. And you can't get to all those parts through the Arduino platform. All you can get to is that one little box right there. Now, by the way, I'm not suggesting there's anything wrong with running like an Arduino. I'm only suggesting that if you're gonna run like an Arduino, you could buy something a lot less expensive than this that will do the same thing. But just to show you, this is a demo, a PSoC test demo. It came from the SparkFun site. In order to get programs to load on the board here, I had to upload a Arduino bootloader, and I'll show you how that happened in a second. And that basically makes this ARM Cortex board seem like an Atmel board and seem like a typical Arduino, and allows things to upload. So what I'm going to do is I am going to push the upload button here, and in a moment we'll see what's happening. There we go. Code is being uploaded to the PSoC. And basically, what this is going to enable is when I push the button, let's see. Okay, one crashed Macintosh later. My poor computer's trying to stream video. It's trying to stream the microscope. It's trying to run Arduino code. If you take a look at this code that we just uploaded to the PSoC, it's got both the hardware and the software serial programmed in it. And what's going to happen is when I press the little user button down here on, let me take you up here and I'll show you. There's the serial output. When of course, it's always difficult to see, but when I press the user button, it says, okay, I recognize the USB button has been pressed. And in fact, not only does the button press, but a little light lights up at the same time. Okay, so that shows you that I can run Arduino code. And in fact, I could probably take any number of Arduinos and do the same exact thing on that. And that's about as exciting as that is. Now, when I want to get the FreeSoc2 set up to work like an Arduino, what I got to do is run the Arduino bootloader. What you do is you download a package from the SparkFun site, and I've done that. And then you have to run, you got to download the PSoC programmer tool from the Cypress website. And I got it right here, PSoC programmer. And if I fire that up, the programmer comes up, and then, I don't want to do that. And I can navigate over to where I've downloaded the PSoC Arduino support file. And I look in there, and I believe in hardware, SparkFun, PSoC. There's bootloader.hex. So what I'll do is I set that up. I open that. And actually, I'm not connected here. I'm in a world of technology. I've got wires on top of wires on top of wires, and I'll plug that guy in. I'm on my Macintosh, so we're running Parallels here, and it all works on Parallels. See, now we're powered, we're connected. And what I do is I basically set kitprog here, and then I upload it to the board. And bada boom, bada bing, I'm done. Now, I don't want to do that right now because I've already done that in the past, but I just wanted to show you how easy that is. What I'm going to do is run PSoC Creator. PSoC Creator allows me to get to all that cool functionality that's in the hardware built in here into this hardware. And so I've brought up just a list of example programs, and you need some kind of outboard hardware like amplifiers and LCD displays to use a bunch of them. But this is a very simple program that I'll run just to illustrate the power of this thing. So what this is going to do is we're going to take the USB file system, but we're going to take a sound in from the USB, pipe it into the DMA. And my sound, what I mean is I'm going to play music through the USB. It's going to be digitized by the file system, and then it's going to be put into memory by the PSoC DMA, direct memory access, right? It's the same as a computer. And then I'm going to read it out again, and I'm going to shove it into the DAC here, the digital to analog converter, and I'm going to take out the output on pin 1. And I suppose I could draw wires between all this, but it's implied that that's what's happening. See, it says VDAC out, DMA done, ISR. That's the interrupt that's going to be called to feed this DAC there. And I'm going to pin 1, which, if I allow this to hover, says that's actually pin 1 is actually P40, P1 underscore, this is P40 on the FreeSoC. Okay, so here I've got my oscilloscope connected to the FreeSoC board. I've got the scope talking to that pin number 1, which is really pin F4.0. And if we go over here, we can see I'm just playing some music through the Windows player, just some demo music. And over there, you can see quite clearly the music is coming through on the oscilloscope. Technology all around. Okay, seeing music on an oscilloscope isn't the same as hearing it. Let's try to listen to it. Okay, so as you've probably been able to tell, I've had to run all the PSoC Creator and PSoC Programmer software from the Windows side of my Macintosh. So I'm using Parallels, running Windows version 8. I've got a little tune playing there through the USB. And if we take a look down here, we see that we're playing through the microcube and hooked up to pin 1 and ground. And there we go. Now, in this case, the FreeSoC is just acting as an amplifier. Hey, I recognize that keyboard player. He was really something in his day. Anyway, so in this case, what's happening is the FreeSoC is just being used as a digital analog converter and amplifier. It's got some op amps in it. It's got audio amplification in it. In fact, you could use the FreeSoC as and hook speakers directly to it in 5-volt mode. You'd have no trouble whatsoever in playing through some speakers. You probably couldn't get a whole lot of volume out of it, but it can drive speakers. It can drive video. There's just a wealth of functionality into it. I just wanted to show you the difference between programming it on the Arduino and programming it using its native software. The native stuff can get a little involved. If you're used to Arduino, it is a bit different. It does have a graphical UI. You paste the blocks together, you push a button, and it programs pretty damn fast. At any rate, that's the FreeSoC 2 from SparkFun. Thank you very, very, very much for watching and listening. I think what I'm going to do, by the way, is once I get my viewership up, I think all of these different boards I'm going to give away because I have way too many of them. I have the FreeSoC. I've got a whole bunch of Arduinos. I've got the Photon. I don't use all of these in my regular life. And so once I hit 1,000 subscribers or so, I think I'll do a big giveaway and mail these things out to people. Meanwhile, thank you very, very, very much for watching the video. I hope it was informative. If there's anything you'd like to see, any of these boards you'd like to know more about, let me know. I'm willing to do more of these little introductory videos